Hello everyone, in this particular session I will discuss about the image interpretation, which is a continuation of a video lecture on remote sensing. So as I had discussed in the previous session, we human beings are capable of interpreting only a few shades of gray, although there are 256 shades of gray. That means different levels of the gray we can identify, or we can interpret only say 9 shades of the gray. So in order to interpret the other shades of the gray, or which are remaining there from which we can't observe from our naked eye, we may have to use the computers for that particular purpose. Hence the image interpretation, which can be identified as the extraction of qualitative and quantitative information in the form of a map about the shape, location, structure, function, quality, condition of the objects, etc., by using human knowledge or experience. This method of interpretation may be either visual or digital, or combination of both. Now there are two types of extraction of information from the images or photographs, namely, first one, interpretation of data by visual analysis, and secondly, semi-automatic processing by computers followed by visual analysis, like generation of vector layer from raster image through on-screen digitization and digital elevation model generations, etc. So these are regarding the two types of extraction of information which is followed in a remote sensing procedure. Now, as I have indicated, as I have used the two important terms in the previous slide, which is nothing but the raster image and the vector image, let us know the difference between the raster image and the vector image here. So, the raster image consists of an array of pixels of various colors, whereas a vector image, it is a collection of points, lines and polygons. Raster image loses quality when scaled up to larger size, whereas vector images are scalable without losing their quality. Raster images are good at displaying large number of colors, whereas vector images are poor at displaying large number of colors. Raster images are of larger file size. The file size is larger here, but in the vector images are of smaller file size. The formats which are there in the raster images, namely JPG, BMP, GIF, TIFF, etc. Obviously some of these file names or formats we will be knowing. Whereas the vector images, some of the known formats are SVG, Scalable Vector Graphics, CGM, Computer Graphics Metafile, as well as our AutoCAD, DXF and PDF comes under the vector images. Now let us know clearly the differences between the raster images and vector images by taking a small example here. So the map which is indicated, which represents the real world conditions, so there the different surface features on the earth, which is clearly indicated here. There is a river which is flowing, as well as on the banks of the bank of the river there are number of trees situated, as well as there is a house which is nearby. So this same condition, which is if you are taking the raster image, which will be represented like this. Say there are nothing but the raster image consists of the rows and columns. So rows are called as the scale lines, as well as columns are called as the pixels. So each pixel is indicated by its digital number. So there you can get the color code also. So you can, if you are observing clearly, just observe here. So that is nothing but wherever the river is there, so the, all the pixels are marked with the blue color. So it indicates that the position, or just nothing but the exact location of the river on the raster image, as well as it is indicated by the letter R. So it is clearly indicating that it is a path followed by a river. Similarly, there is a another set of pixels which is also indicated with the green color, so which is written over there. That is nothing but the P means it is a plantation, and so it is nothing but number of trees which are indicated here, so in these pixels. So similarly, there is a small yellow dot is also there, which is indicated with the letter H. So it is indicating that the position of the house on the image which is captured. So this is regarding the raster representation of the real world. On the other hand, you can observe the vector representation of the same real world. So it is nothing but just like the x-axis as well as y-axis, it is indicated the path which is followed by the river, which is indicated by this zigzag line and a small polygon. So there is nothing but connecting all the dots, which indicates this the plantation which is there, or the trees which are situated over that particular area, as well as a small dot which is indicating there. That is nothing but the location of a house. So this is regarding the vector representation of the real world. So it is a interpretation is the combined result of identification of surface features through photo recognition elements, field verification, and preparation of final thematic maps. So we should know that is nothing but what are the surface features, where it is situated on in the real world conditions, as well as what are the basic properties of those surface features. Maybe it is the geometric conditions, maybe it is other than that, maybe is a physical characteristics, maybe other than that, any characteristics, specific characteristic features that can be studied by visiting to the field. Similarly, the final stage will be the preparation of the thematic maps. So thematic map is in the it is a type of the map specifically designed to show a particular theme which is connected with a specific geographic area, maybe such as temperature variation, rainfall distribution, or population density, etc. So these are regarding certain themes we can select. For example, temperature variation you can select, so there we can get the warmer place as well as the cooler places, or which are they situated on the earth, which can locate by means of that thematic map. Similarly, population density you can prepare a thematic map showing or getting taking by taking the population density. There you can get the densely populated area as well as the lightly or the less density less population density area also, which can clearly distinguish from the image. So then the combination of three bands generates a color composite images. So if we are studying the image interpretation particularly in the remote sensing context, we should know what are the color composite which are used in order to interpret the images. So there are two color composites which we are using here in the image interpretation technique, namely true color composite image as well as false color composite image. So whereas the true color composite, in the sense the primary bands like a blue, green, red bands which are visible which are in the visible spectrum, which we are using to interpret the particular image. So whereas the false color composite image, it is an artificially generated color image in which blue, green, and red colors are assigned to the wavelength regions to which they do not belong in nature. So that means, for example, the standard false color composite blue is assigned to green radiation, green is assigned to red radiation, and red is assigned to near infrared radiation. So this is gives you the standard false color composite, where the different wavelengths or different bands which are assigned to the band or the wavelength which are not particularly belong in nature. So that is regarding the preparation of the false color composite image. Now, as I was discussing about the true color image as well as false color composite image, so here with this example, we can clearly understand what is the importance of false color composite. So this particular map, which is indicating a gulf portion here, so the sea is penetrating into the land. So here, this is a true color image. The coastal line there, although I have plotted here, it is nothing but roughly there, you can't clearly distinguish the coastal line as well as the vegetation. Healthy vegetation around this particular area is also not observed clearly. So this is the major drawback in the interpretation. So this, due to this condition, the interpretation cannot be done up to the degree what is desired. So here, instead of this, we can use the false color composite image. So there, it is showing now the false color infrared image, with the red being the near infrared band, which we cannot see. But we know that the healthy vegetation, it is clearly visible in the near infrared band, which I had indicated, I had explained in the previous session. So the, in order to visualize the healthy vegetation, we must use the near infrared band. So if you are using now near infrared band, so there the coastal line, which is, you can clearly distinguish the coastal line as well as the healthy vegetation is also observed clearly. So this is regarding the importance of false color composite image. So now there are certain elements which helps the process of interpretation, so it can simplify our image interpretation. So these elements we will discuss now one by one. So first is nothing but the shape. So many natural as well as human made or artificial features have unique shapes. So that is nothing but the geometrical shapes of these objects may be different. So like linear, curvilinear, circular, elliptical, radial, square, rectangular, triangular, hexagonal, star, elongated, etc., etc. You can list out many such shapes which are observed in our nature. Maybe it is artificial one, or maybe it is natural one. So depending upon this particular shape, so we can roughly interpret what is the type of the object or what is the nature of the object, that is roughly can be interpreted if we know its shape. Now the second one is nothing but the size. So always the size of the object on images must be considered with respect to its scale or the resolution. So we have to view the size of the object from our scale point of view, or the resolution whatever we have taken in order to prepare that map. So that we have to look into account. So it is important to assess the size of the target relative to other objects in the scene, as well as the absolute size to aid in the interpretation of that particular target. So sometimes what we have to do is nothing but the size of a target, we have to compare it with the adjacent object. So there you can get the clear interpretation. A quick approximation of target size can make direct interpretation to an appropriate result more quickly. So there is, if the time taken for the interpretation by comparing these relative sizes, so there the interpretation becomes very faster. So the most measured parameters are length, width, perimeter, area, and occasionally the volume. So these are known or widely used parameters, which in the case of image interpretation. Now in the example there you can see, so if an Interpreter had to distinguish zones of land use and had identified an area with a number of buildings in it. So large buildings such as factories or warehouses would suggest commercial property, whereas small buildings would indicate the residential use. So there the size may be different. So residential or the buildings or the small apartment, the size may be different, as well as the factory, as well as the warehouses or storage places or the silos may be having the size which is different. So size may be more. So depending upon which, we can interpret whether it is a residential building or whether it is commercial building. So there you can bifurcate among these various surface features. Now the next one is nothing but the shadows. So shadow, it is a reduction is of concern in remote sensing. Oftenly this shadow, which may give the idea, or it is nothing but it can help our interpretation by describing the shape of the object, or it is nothing but the dimension of the object is also sometimes it is can be clearly interpreted by means of its shape. For example, it is a pyramid which is indicated here in this particular diagram. So there you can see the shadow, it is triangular. So there you can get the interpretation, or the observation says that there is a triangular object which is almost triangular object which is resting or is standing over the ground. So there is a the shadow which plays an important role. Meanwhile, this shadow is also having certain limitation, or it is nothing but sometimes it hinders the interpretation also, where the tall building is there whose shadow is falling on other objects which are nearby. So that if we want to interpret the objects which are there inside the shadow, it cannot be clearly interpreted. So due to the presence of the shadow. So this is regarding the problems are also there, as well as the advantages are also there with the presence in the presence of shadow. Next is nothing but the tone and color. So a band of electromagnetic radiation recorded by a remote sensing instrument can be displayed on an image in shades of gray ranging from black to white. As you know that there are different shades of the gray, so but our naked eye can observe only few among them. So we may have to use the computers for that particular purpose. These shades, which are called as tones normally, and can be qualitatively referred to as dark, light, or intermediate tones. So whenever we are talking about the tone is related to the amount of light reflected from the scene in a specific wavelength interval, or the band. Wavelength interval is nothing but the band. So here the example which is given here, the figure represents a band image in a near infrared region. So this image or the of an area which consists of healthy vegetation, as well as there is a river which is flowing in this particular area. So if you are using near infrared region of the electromagnetic spectrum, rivers does not reflect in a near infrared region. So we know that in the spectral response curve, that the visible spectrum with the help of which the water which can be clearly distinguished. So visible spectrum, that is nothing but red, green, blue bands, which are helpful in identifying or interpreting the presence of the water body on the earth. Similarly, near infrared may be helpful in predicting or interpreting the vegetation which is present on the earth surface. So here our eyes can discriminate only 16 to 20 gray levels in the black and white photograph, while more than hundreds of colors that can be distinguished in a color photograph. So in a multispectral imaging, optimal three bands are used to generate color composite images, whereas pulse color composite using near infrared, red and green are the most preferred combination for visual interpretation. So we are using almost three important bands in the preparation of the false color composite image. So that means the near infrared is used, red is used along with the green. So this is widely used combination in order to prepare the false color composite. So in a standard false color composite, usually the near infrared band passes through the red channel, red band passes through the green channel, and green band passes through the blue channel. So as a result of which, the vegetation reflects much in the NIR region, near infrared region, as you can see here. So the electromagnetic spectrum, therefore in standard false color composite, vegetation appears red, which is more suitable in the vegetation identification. Similarly, if we want to use the if you want to interpret the river here or the water body, we have to use the visible spectrum. So therefore definitely sometimes these false color composite will help us in the interpretation process. Now the next one is nothing but the texture. So normally the texture refers to the arrangement of these tones or colors in an image. So usually, because earth features that exhibit similar tones offer exhibit different textures. So different surface features, for example forest or the agricultural land, or it is a randomly dispersed vegetation, so as well as grass on the earth surface, so each may have different textures. So adjectives include smooth, uniform, homogeneous textures, intermediate and rough textures. In the rough textures, again it is a coarse or heterogeneous textures are used normally. So in the example, you can see here the similar kinds of reflectance color appear throughout the image. So that is nothing but color is same, so almost it is green color. Now three distinct land cover types which we can observe from this image, if we view or if we observe this particular image from the texture point of view, there you can get almost three distinct land covers. So the first one is nothing but the triangular patch at the bottom left corner. So bottom left corner, as you can get, that is nothing but the triangular patch. So this refers, that is nothing but the plantation which has a rough texture where individual trees can be seen. Right side on the top, so see, it is nothing but what? So this is nothing but this particular portion. There you can see the plantation. Okay, so now the right side on the top of the image, right side on the top of the image, there you can see the trees are closer together and the tree canopies merge together forming medium textural patterns. So medium textural patterns, so this one. Now lastly, that is nothing but what, the bottom right corner. So right bottom corner, that is nothing but somewhere here in this particular image. Here if you observe the smooth texture, so smooth texture vegetation we are getting, so indicating that it is probably an open field with short grass. It is a open field with short grass. So therefore there is the almost three different land cover types which can be clearly distinguished if we are taking that, or if you are viewing the image from the textural point of view. So then next is nothing but the pattern is the spatial arrangement of objects on the landscape. So the general descriptions which are used to interpret or identify the pattern are a random and a systematic pattern, natural and a human-made pattern, etc. Furthermore, specific descriptions which include are circular, oval, curvilinear, linear, radiating, rectangular, etc. So these are some of the specific descriptions used to identify or to name certain specific pattern which is shown in a particular scene. So there are some of the examples which are indicated here in the two images. So first image indicates that the number of houses which are built in a residential colony, and the second one is nothing but there are number of aircrafts which are shown in the particular right side image. So there it shows us some regular pattern, so that it is nothing but an army base. You can identify as army base station. So whereas the first one is nothing but a residential colony. Now the next one is nothing but the association. So in some of the cases, the objects which are lying there, or the surface feature which are lying nearby to the adjacent objects which will have the clear impact in identifying the particular objects in the particular scene. For example, there is a tower which is shown here in this particular image, so which resembles a shape of a silo. So from this we can identify that in this particular area there may be a thermal reactor or nuclear power plant or a storage silo which is situated in this particular area. So this is regarding the association. So altogether, so it constitutes the elements which are used in the digital interpretation technique. Now similarly, the resolution. So resolution is nothing but it is the ability and quality of a sensor to view or detect the objects in the scene or the imagery. In satellite sensor, it is four types of the resolution which are used, namely spatial, spectral, temporal and radiometric resolution. So as this resolution also plays an important role in the identification of the objects, or it is nothing but in the digital image interpretation. So this also can be included in the elements of digital elements of interpretation, digital image interpretation. So here the modern sensors are capable of acquiring high resolution imagery, so which helps in making large scale maps for better planning and monitoring. So let us discuss these resolutions or type of the resolution one by one. So first one is nothing but the spatial resolution. So spatial resolution is nothing but it is the smallest unit that can be resolved. So smallest unit that can be resolved. So fine or the high resolution, that means small objects are discernible. The spatial, the size of the field of view. So that is nothing but the meaning of the spatial. So for example, 10 by 10 meter grid or 5 meter grid, etc. So there is regarding the spatial resolution. So here in the example you can observe the first one is nothing but it is 0.5 by 0.5 meter spatial resolution, whereas the last one, the right corner, you can have the image which is captured by having the spatial resolution of 20 by 20 meter. So there, compared to the 20 meter by 20 meter spatial resolution, you feel like this 0.5 meter by 0.5 meter is more enhanced, the quality is more enhanced. There you can clearly interpret the objects or the surface features which are there on the Earth's surface. Now the spectral response, this is the ability of the sensor to define fine wavelength intervals. For example, the first case, black and white film, so including blue, green, red, or the combination of three these bands. So we are not bifurcating these bands. So collectively, from 0.4 micrometers to 0.7 micrometer wavelength, we are looking in the imagery, or it is a scene, it is viewed. So it is nothing but gives you the black and white film. Whereas the color film, which has the specific bands or the specific wavelength range for the blue, green as well as red, there you can distinguish, or the bifurcation is made with respect to the wavelength. For example, 0.4 to 0.5 micrometer, that is of blue band, 0.5 to 0.6, that is of green band, and 0.6 to 0.7 is nothing but about the red band. So the narrower band, the band, the greater the spectral resolution. So the greater the spectral resolution, then we can interpret in a better way. Next is nothing but the temporal resolution. So temporal resolution is the capability of the satellite to image the exact same area at the same waving angle at different periods of the time. So which represents the frequency with which the satellite can revisit an area of interest and acquire a new image. So revisiting time here considered as the time between two successive image acquisitions over the same particular area. So for example, in the image, as you can observe, there is a satellite which is having 16 days revisiting time. So for example, July 2nd, it has visited, it has acquired some information over a particular area, then again it is going to be visiting on July 18th. Again it will be visiting the same area on August 3rd. So this is a 16 days interval, so that is called as revisiting time. Again, there may be another satellite which may be having the revisiting time around 11 days interval. So July 1st, it may visit that particular area. July 12th, it may again visit the same particular area. So therefore, if we want to get the change which is happened in among the surface features on the Earth about from July 2nd to July 18th, so then we can refer the data from the first satellite. Similarly, if you are interested in getting the informations or the changes which are happened during this interval from July 1st to July 12th, so then we can make use of the data from the second satellite. So this is regarding the importance of temporal resolution. Similarly, last one is nothing but the radiometric resolution. The sensitivity of detectors to scale small differences in electromagnetic energy is called as radiometric resolution. So there is nothing but the sensitivity of detectors to scale small differences in electromagnetic energy. So we know that there are almost 256 gray levels or the different shades of the gray in an 8-bit image, so which is indicated here in this the image. So there the grayscale is also indicated here. So from black to white, we are having black is nothing but a zero, and white is indicated with the number 255 in an 8-bit image. Similarly, if we want to calculate the number of gray levels, so then we have to take 2 to the power of that number of bytes. For example, 2 to the power of 8 bit image, if you are seeing 2 to the power of 8, so is equal to 256. There will be almost 256 levels of gray or shades of gray you can find. So similarly, you can count. So 1-bit image, so what is the number of gray level, so range also you can get. And similarly, 8-bit image, 256 from 0 to 255 you can get. So different bits, for the different bits, different gray levels will be there, the range will also be different. So here in the right corner you can have another example. So 8-bit quantization, so which almost covers 256 levels of gray or shades of gray, so there the image is clearly visible or interpreted better in a possible manner. So here in the last one, that is nothing but 1-bit quantization, 2 levels, so which is of a poor quality. So there the compared to the 1-bit quantization, so we can have the 8-bit quantization, or we can prefer 8-bit quantization over 1-bit quantization. So depending upon the gray levels which are included in that particular scene. So coming to the advantages and limitations. So now, advantages of remote sensing are: this technique provides data of large areas and provides data of very remote and inaccessible regions. Third, able to obtain imagery of any area over a continuous period of time through which the any anthropogenic or natural changes in the landscape can be analyzed. So that is nothing but any artificial change or the natural change which has happened in that particular area that can be analyzed in a better possible manner. So then relatively inexpensive when compared to employing a team of surveyors. Easy and rapid collection of data is possible. Rapid production of maps for interpretation is also possible in the case of the remote sensing. So these are some of the advantages of remote sensing. Similarly, the limitations of remote sensing are, first one, the interpretation of imagery requires a certain skill level. So skilled labors or skilled personnel are required here in order to perform the remote sensing. So then needs cross verification with the ground survey data. So it is not only, it consists of the data or the imagery we are collecting from the satellites. Once we have to cross verify it, we have to visit the field, we have to check the proper position or the location of the surface feature, and it's some of the features like or the properties of the that particular object or the surface feature we may have to cross verify. So then data from multiple sources may create confusion here. Then objects can be misclassified or confused. So then distortions may occur in an image due to the relative motion of the sensor and the source. So as the satellites are in continuous motion, so a real-time data handling system is required. If any failure happens or it is nothing but malfunction happens in the data processing state, so then these distortions which may occur in a particular image may hinder the interpretation. So these are regarding limitations of the remote sensing. So finally, the remote sensing applications. So we have to discuss here at the end. So first is nothing but land use mapping. So remote sensing data is useful in obtaining up-to-date land use pattern of large areas at any given time, and also monitor changes that occur from time to time. So the change which has happened among the surface features, it can also record. So similarly, it can be used in the interpretation stage. So it can be used for updating army establishments. So if any change has happened in that, or the variation in that army establishments, so that can be observed clearly. So then land use pattern, change in the land use pattern, that can be easily interpreted. Road maps, change in the road map, that is nothing but updated information regarding the road network, so that can be also viewed. Asphalt conditions, so the deterioration which has caused or any damage which has caused to the asphalt, or the how the pavement is, so that also which can be checked here. So it is nothing but the observed frequently. So and wetland delineation, so delineation of wetland, so that is also can be observed. So this information is used by army personnel, town transport planners and administrators to frame policy matters for all round development of the region. So this is a very much a vast application area, so where the remote sensing is very much important in performing these particular or in satisfying these particular aspects. So then second one is nothing but weather forecasting. So remote sensing is extensively used in India for weather forecasting. It is also used to warn people about impending cyclones. Then third one is nothing but the environmental study. It can be used to study deforestation, degradation of fertile lands, pollution in atmosphere, desertification, eutrophication of large water bodies, and oil spillage from oil tankers, etc. So there is a different mechanisms which may impact the environment, so that also can be studied in a better possible manner. Then so the next one is nothing but study of natural hazards. So remote sensing can be used to study the damages which are caused by earthquakes, volcanoes, landslides, floods, and melting of ice in polar regions. So in sometimes, so we may have to simulate by taking the models which are maybe used in the watershed management, or it is nothing but to study the melting of the ice in polar regions due to temperature rise. So in those particular conditions, so we may use this data which are available from the remote sensing effectively. So many times remote sensing will be helpful to predict the occurrence of natural hazards. The last one is nothing but about the resource exploration. So remote sensing data is helpful for updating existing geological maps, rapid preparation of lineament and tectonic maps, that means the areas which are under the seismic zones, identifying the sites for quarrying the mineral, and helpful in locating fossil fuel deposits, etc. Wherever the valuable mineral sources are available, so then we can identify in a better possible manner. So similarly, later on we can do the mining activities there. So these are regarding some of the important application areas of remote sensing. Thank you.